fishing. People, when you're in the mood, let's go fishing. Well, it's just me and you. Head on down to the fishing hole. Grab your hat, get your pole. Let's go fishing. When you're in the mood.
Canadian Sport Fishing is brought to you in part by Rapala, premium fishing gear crafted from experience. Yamaha, conquer outdoors. Dickies, quality workwear since 1922. Blue Cam, a cleaner running engine for a cleaner environment.
Talk about being peaceful. This is wonderful. It's springtime. And what I'm doing is I'm targeting some little big fish. Does that make any sense to you? Look it. You can see why they call them bluegill. They are pretty fish. And look, did he want that jig? That one's about 8 inches long. I'm looking for ones that are mammoths, up to about 10 inches. So I'm just gonna drop him into the water. He hasn't been out very long. There he goes. And this is the little grub I was using. It's actually made by my friend, Scott Martin. He's in Newfoundland. They get a lot of trout there. For some reason, when you're dealing in clear water, it's very, very effective. My only challenge is it's windy and I have this little wand. It's like an ultralight rod. So what I'm doing is just casting it up onto this bank. It's a mixture of bulrush, those little buggy whips, and also some light grass. This is kind of like sight casting for some saltwater fish. I don't know if this one's any bigger. I think they're beautiful. They kind of remind me of like an angelfish in saltwater, only they're not, you know, black and white. I'm wondering if these bigger ones are big males. And I got a very light leader. You know what? This guy is heavier. You could probably get some fillets off it, but we're releasing the guy. Look it. We're talking about like, look at those stripes. They are just a work of art. They're beautiful. I'm being conservative at 9.5. I'd say he's almost 10. You know, most of the time, you just don't catch panfish anywhere. Sometimes you get them incidentally fishing in deep water, shallow water, but to actually target larger panfish and to target them where they're concentrated in groups, really you have to find the right location. And I find early in the year, when the water temperatures are starting to approach 50 degrees Fahrenheit, you have to look for shallow mud bottom or sand bottom bays where the weeds are just starting to grow up. And a lot of times, those panfish will be right around the new weed growth, or they'll be right on the edges of weeds that are growing along the bank. Man, there's gotta be a bunch of them right on that edge. This is a pumpkin seed. Nice variety, changing it up. Just like the sun with those nice stripes on his face. You know, for guys that are really serious about their panfish, and I remember fishing the Kawartha Lakes in Ontario and wondering why these Americans had these really long rods and they like didn't have reels on them. Now this is a small pumpkin seed. Look, I think they're pretty. These are like the perfect fish for kids to learn how to fish with, using a bobber and a worm, but we're using artificials. You know, for the guys that I saw with those long rods and literally no reels on, I was wondering what they were doing. And all they were doing was just dropping the line down. So if you can imagine, if I had like a crappie pole, which you can buy mostly in the States, they don't sell them so much here in Canada, but if you had a 10 to 20 foot crappie pole and you had a eight or 10 length of line on, you could just dab it along the edges here and get one fish after another. You know, you gotta fish in comfort. And one thing I've learned, if I wear shoes that I can get wet, it's really important. Like this morning, when I was launching the boat, the launch was kind of tapered. So I ended up going back and forth from the truck 3 or 4 times and going in the water. And these Leguano that I'm wearing are excellent because they breathe, you can get them wet, and they dry right away. And I like them because they're slip-on. So on the boat, fishing all day, I really like these little stubs that they have underneath because it gives you a little bit of cushion. And when I combine that to the vigorous mats that I put in the boat and the seats, it's really comfortable. I can fish all day long.
Closed captioning is brought to you by Cable's Eyewear Retainer. Lightweight, comfortable, adjustable, and waterproof.
Most panfish eat a lot of crustaceans and invertebrates. So that means they're eating small food that are in shallower water. So it could be crayfish, it could be leeches, it could be flying insects that they're in their aquatic stage. So for that reason, we downsize all of the lures that we use. Most panfish fishermen will use live bait. They'll actually use minnows or worms. But I like to use artificials with small jig heads, ultralight rods, and have a blast. You know, one thing that I gotta stress for this kind of fishing that I'm doing, because of the conditions, the water's pretty clear. I can actually see where the break is. And with my sunglasses on, I don't want to break that really light tippet. Come on, good, it pulled off. I can actually see the fish come up to it sometimes. So the glasses that I'm wearing are Maui Jims. After fishing for over 40 years in different parts of the world and wearing all kinds of glasses, I've really come to appreciate good quality sunglasses, that they're not just comfortable, but that gives you very good visibility into the water. I just missed another fish. I think because of this wind, they're being a little bit spooky. Come on. Oh, that was a big one. 10 inches, 11 inches. Float under, float up. Trying to keep it out of that grass. Come on, gotta watch that leader. Yeah, when I lift them up, I can really tell, you know, that they're a little bit heavier. Look at, just gorgeous. You can see those nice bars again. This one, I don't think is 8 inches, but just, he sucked that float under beautifully. He's got that grub, very lightly hooked. You know, if you're using a real worm, you'd probably get one fish after the other. But with the grubs, the plastic grubs, it's a little bit more challenging. You know, panfish, though they're small and they're voracious feeders, in the springtime when they're moving into shallow water and they've got spawning on their mind, besides feeding, can actually be quite tricky to catch. I find that you have to have the right size jig head, and the only way you can find that is by experimenting. It could be anywhere from a 1/32nd ounce up to 1 1/8 ounce for a faster drop rate. Also, if you're using artificial grubs, the color of your grub, the length of your grub, and the action is really important. Most of the time, the only way you can know what the right combination is trial and error. Sometimes in shallow water, you can actually spot the fish and see how they respond to the little offering that you have. Once you find it, though, you should get one right after the other. Doesn't that look appetizing? That's the Lunker City Helgi, or Helgramite. So it's got a very flexible tail. You can see it's very limp. It's got those little legs, the little arms. And I'm going to show you how you rig it on a 1/16 ounce jig head. I put the light colored belly, which is like a pearl colored, down. I put the hook through the center of it, and I run it up about the length of the shaft of the hook. So I want it to be straight. So I'm going to run up about that far, and I'm going to push it straight up onto the jig head. So come on, you got to admit, that looks pretty fishy for a fish to grab. Now, I fished it mostly today with a float, and instead of using a traditional bobber, either made out of plastic or made out of foam, I went with the quill. So the quill is right here. This is the porcupine quill, and the way I've attached it is I've taken two small pieces of surgical tubing, one here, so I put the tubing on the line first, and then I slide the actual quill in, and one up here. So it's very easy for me to remove the quill. All I do is pop it out at both ends. So this quill actually will support a 1/16 ounce jig head perfectly. And what I like about the quills, unlike like a goose quill, it's actually quite heavy. It almost feels like glass in your hands. So when you cast it, it just shoots and cuts right through the wind. And when it's sitting in the water, about that much of it is sticking up. So I'm gonna say about 1/3. And when a fish goes to pull it, because it's actually quite heavy, there's no resistance. So usually you see this and then just disappear. And of course you set the hook. Wow, this is a nice pumpkin seed. He was right on the edge of this deep water, because I can't see the bottom here. It's interesting because I was fishing the float and I was using a vertical presentation, that jig going up and down. And it seems almost like they were following it, but very few fish were actually grabbing it. This guy isn't overly thick, but he's nice. Look, when he's bigger than your hand, you know, it's a nice panfish. A lot of people call them all sunfish, and they are part of the sunfish family. The rock bass, the white bass isn't, it's its own family. Yeah, for some reason they like that drop, and maybe it's the pink color too, look. Beautiful and lovely release. The most popular panfish are probably crappie, yellow perch, bluegill, and pumpkin seed. One of the fish that I like the most, though, is the bluegill. For some reason, they just have a pugnacious attitude. And also their shape. The bigger they get, you know, the rounder shape they become. And they get big shoulders and a little head and a small mouth. But they are so aggressive when it comes to hitting jigs, especially with plastic grubs. I think they're fun to catch, and a lot of times you can get them up in the 9.5 to 10 inch range, and they fight like crazy for their size, especially when you get them on ultralight outfits. Yes. This rock bass is almost fighting like a small, like smallmouth or largemouth. Come here. Reminds me of the ones we were getting up north when we were at a place called Elk Island Resort. Oh, and you know what? The hook just fell out of it. So there's a nice rock bass. You know, some people call them red eye. If you look closely, you can see they actually have red around their eye. So that one has got to be pushing 10 inches. So it's a good size. But look at the size of his mouth. There's no problem getting my thumb in there. Not like the pumpkin seed or the bluegill. I thought I had him hooked well, but as soon as I grabbed his lower jaw, that hook just pulled out. You know, I'm reading the specs on this MFS, little one grub that worked really well. It's a 1/32nd ounce. I thought it was 1/16. It's pink coach dog with a pink head, black eye. You got all that? It says right here on the package. So I thought I was using a 1/16. I was actually using a 1/32nd ounce. That's what this little jig is right here. So amazing. So this is the actual color right here. This is a bigger one, just so you can appreciate it. You see it's got a darker mark on one side, curly tail with a little bit of dark, like red on the tip. And then on the other side, it's got three little white specks. Look at the little ones here. Now you gotta look real close. See how tiny they are? And I'm gonna show you that jig head, because it is small. I have it right there. So there's one rigged up right here. So it's funny because I thought it was 1/16 ounce. It's 1/32nd. That is tiny. Can you see how tiny that head is? So this one you can see is really tattered because I've caught so many fish on it. The grub was about 1/4 inch longer, but it's just kind of slipped back. So I've just kept putting it back on the hook. But that head is very small. Because of that lighter head and thicker body, you get a really slow descent rate and that tail's still working a little bit. So I think that's why they have time to come up and literally inhale it. Remember, both the bluegill and the pumpkin seed are pretty small mouths. And when you get to a 1/32nd ounce jig, that hook is very tiny. So they can actually grab it. And most of them were hooked really well. So that's what they look like. So you can see that's the one with that complicated name. They're small, but you know what? They are deadly. Tell you what, they're great eating. I might keep a few of these. My dad loves panfish, and you know what? These aren't bad. They take on the color of their surroundings. So this guy was caught just off the reeds and grass. So I think he's a little bit darker. These rods are really ultralight or light action. The one in my right hand is very soft. You can see when I just shake it lightly, that tip bends from about halfway up the rod to the tip. So that's ideal if I'm just casting a very small jig. What I've got on there is a tiny 1/36 ounce jig head. So when I cast it out, I want a really light rod because I normally can't feel the fish come up and hit it. When I go to lift up, my rod bends a little bit and I know I have a fish on. So having a soft, supple, ultralight rod works really well. And you gotta match it with the right size reel. So that's a small size reel. And I'm using that Suffix Tangerine line. And with both of them, a fluorocarbon leader. The other light action rod or ultralight is a little bit stiffer. That's because I've got the float on there and I want to have a little bit more stiffness when I go to set the hook because I'm also pulling the float when I set the hook. And I'm using a little bit heavier jig head. That's a 1/16 ounce on this one. And you can see that even this reel is small. This would be a number one size or ultralight. This is that bright Suffix 832, very light braid, and it's that chartreuse or green color. And again, I'm using the fluorocarbon leader. So matching the size of rods, you know, when you get these small fish that are under 11 inches, you can still have lots of fun if you match the fish, the size of the fish, with the size of the fishing outfits. Ultralight fishing is a blast for them. You know, to locate panfish, you can fish bays or fish shallow shorelines where there's weeds. But what we did this week was actually fish a creek channel where it opened up and became almost like a river, but close to where it goes into one of the Great Lakes. We found that the fish will come in from the main body of water where it's a little bit deeper and there's very little vegetation. And when they come into the estuary or the bottom part of the tributary or creek, there's a lot of sediments, and that's where the weeds start growing and the water warms up a little bit quicker. There's also a lot of vegetation that grows along the shoreline and right into the water. And if it's 2 or 3 feet deep, that's ideal habitat. When you catch both species of fish in a smaller area, you know, like a smaller pond or a lake, they tend to be smaller in size a lot of the time because of competition. They actually become stunted. But when you're fishing a large body of water like one of the Great Lakes and you find panfish habitat, your chances of getting a big one are really good. Look, I got cleaned. You remember I was saying that you get so many fish on one grub and it works so well? Well, I happen to have a few more. So look, just, I wanted to say, look, if you can look at that, tell me if that looks realistic. Here, I'll shake it a little bit for you. Look at that tail hanging down. So you can imagine when this is going through the water, it's got little legs. This is that helgramite or helgi that they call it. It's got like a pearl belly and then just that very natural top with that small, small jig head. Let's see if it's gonna produce. I think I'm on a gar pattern. Is it gonna throw it? Look at that little beak. This is a mini gar, and it makes sense because I'm using a little ultralight outfit. Should be using the net. He's not really a fighter. So, it's got a teeth-studded mouth. Can you see any little teeth there? Can you imagine being a fish and getting tagged by that? Now, he might fly out of my hands, because I can feel he wants a wiggle. Look, this is a tiny gar, but it's kind of fun on ultralight. See the nice mottles he's got down the side? Beautiful. Now you can see that long yap in his teeth. Look at it, it's like a snake, gone. I had a lot of fun catching the panfish today, and normally I would keep some for eating, but today I just wanted to catch them, enjoy them, see how nice they are, and then release them. If you're planning on keeping any panfish for eating, you know, you can fillet them if they get big, but I would say, you know what? Just scale them, cut the head off, gut them, and then rinse them off well, and they're ready for the deep fryer or even doing them in a frying pan. Look at that pumpkin seed fight. Head thrashing, trying to throw that hook, sizzling runs. Look at. Good thing I got a big, strong rod. Notice where his tail's working back and forth, that's the wind. So we got quite a bit of wind here. And he ate that. I had him on about 3 times before I hooked him with that little grub. And you know what? It's gonna be a flying fish. Actually, it's gonna be a fish drop right there and gone. Look at how beautiful that bluegill is. That is a chunky bluegill. Man, look at that. Isn't that a gorgeous bluegill? Do I need to take a measurement? Maybe. Look at the colors. I mean, look at, it's like iridescence. It's blue near the anal fin. Look at under here, the throat is kind of dark. So this guy is just shy of 9 inches. He's 8.5. So for a bluegill, when you get like between 8 and 10 inches, I mean, an 11 incher is a whopper. But I think they're so beautiful. Look, don't we make a nice picture? You know, every May, end of May, beginning of June of every year, for almost the last 16 years, I look forward to a major event that happens right down here in Windsor, Ontario, on the Detroit River. And it's the ICHA Handicapable Fishing Derby. So this has been going on for 16 years, and we've been coming down, I think we missed 1 year. And I love seeing all of the young people and older people that are all along the waterfront and catching fish and just having a wonderful time. But I also come down because of the excellent walleye fishing and some of the other fish that you catch, like bass, white bass, smallmouth bass, and large freshwater drum and so on. Coming down to the Detroit River in the springtime is one of my highlights.
This is a fantastic event. I really appreciate the effort, the time that gets put in, the volunteers, and the people that come down, seeing the smiles on all of the children's and the kids' faces, the young adults that are here fishing. It's phenomenal.
I agree fully. Last night, I spoke, they asked me to speak a little bit at the sponsor appreciation dinner, mm-hmm. and I told them that this is one of the few times when invisible people become visible.
Absolutely.
Because a lot of the people that are out, you don't see them in malls, you don't see them in stores, you don't see them in coffee shops, because a lot of them need a lot of assistance. But you see them here today. Princess, I've never seen a real princess before.
I just might freeze you, that's all.
Okay, well, I ice fish. Do you ice fish? Because you like cold weather, right?
I could give you ice right now.
No, please don't. Please don't.
Canadian Sport Fishing has been brought to you in part by Rapala, premium fishing gear crafted from experience. Yamaha, conquer outdoors. Dickies, quality workwear since 1922. Bluechem, a cleaner running engine for a cleaner environment.
How are we doing?
With my daughter, Erica.
Is Erica resting? Erica, can I shake your hand? How are you? How come he's holding the fishing rod? Are you warm enough? I think you should have like a hot chocolate or something. Yeah. No? You don't like hot chocolate? I like hot chocolate, especially today. Have you had any bites yet? You have to be patient. Sometimes it takes a while.